It is a pleasure to be here to give this talk, and some of you may be surprised, but there are actually other fronts beside the Middle East and the Western Front. So I'm going to talk about them. I'm going to start out with the Eastern Front, or Russia, and tell you the differences between the Eastern and Western Fronts, but I want to show you these slides first. Realize that the Russian Empire back in that time spread over 7 time zones. This is the Eastern Front, a lot of fighting. I'll tell you in a minute the significance of it. I'm going to talk about the Kerensky Offensive, the destruction of the Russian army in 1917 briefly, and show you this area. Anyway, the first thing I want to do is talk to you so you understand the differences between the Western and the Eastern Fronts. Most obvious is distances. The Western Front was 375 miles or so, but the Eastern Front was 900 miles. This meant that even the Russian army, the largest in Europe, could not man positions on the entire front. The other thing you should be aware of on the Eastern Front, as well as often on the Western Front, the railroads are the keys to where the major battles are fought. When you read about the battles on the Eastern Front, keep in mind one thing. The Russians knew, the Germans, and Austro-Hungarians knew, if they advanced 200 miles, they had no logistical system left. So that explains why some of the campaigns that could have been a greater victory or a different outcome happened. And obviously, you've got industrial France and Britain. This is not true of Austria-Hungary and Russia. They are industrially and economically totally unprepared to fight a major war. Another difference with the Eastern Front is that if you could, by surprise, deploy a large number of troops and the other side was not aware of it, you would have a major victory. This is behind Gorlice at Tarnov in 1915, where the Russians only got word that a German army had started to deploy there, didn't notice the peasants had left the fields in no man's land. Also, many fewer airplanes. The Germans would send their planes, their pilots were worn out, and the planes to the Eastern Front, far fewer, but also recognize that in the winter, air reconnaissance could not work. The railroad lines, all the key things were covered with snow. It's one of the reasons there weren't great battles during that. And the other factor is, and I love this because my book, The Carpathian Winter War, showed conclusively in one battle, in less than 3 months, the casualties were greater than the so-called blood battles of Verdun and Somme, which lasted 6 and 9 months together. The other thing is the effect of the weather on the Eastern Front and even the Balkan Front, which I'll talk about. Also want to mention that when these countries are not prepared for war, Austria, Hungary, and Russia, the Germans gave the Austro-Hungarian government 100 million marks a month to keep them viable, as well as raw materials, etc. And one of the key problems with the Central Powers was the command question, which I'm sorry I don't have time to go into, but Russia got many of its weapons and its ammunition from the Western powers as well, and both would build airplanes from plans from their stronger allies. I do want to mention one interesting thing you may not be aware of, but when the war ended and the Bolshevik civil war began, there were tons of material on the docks at Archangel Vladivostok. So British, French, American, and even Japanese troops came in. In the 1930s, Stalin made the remark, right after the Cold War, he said the Cold War started when the Americans invaded Russia in 1919. Anyway, in 1914, much of the war was pretty much decided on the Eastern Front because the Russians invaded Austria-Hungary. They invaded it and won an overwhelming victory. They wiped out 40% of the million-plus man Austro-Hungarian army. How did they do that? I don't want to go into Konrad von Hötzendorf and him not being a very good commander. But he kept his eyes up north, and the Russians, meanwhile, because Austro-Hungarian airplanes were very defective and because the Russian army moved at night, invaded from the east, 21 divisions that would be hit at the same time by the Austro-Hungarians attacking with 3 to 5 divisions. Needless to say, you can see the outcome. Now, I'm giving this background because the key to understand the Eastern Front in many ways that helps bring the collapse are the enormous casualties, incredible casualties. On the German front, you know about Tannenberg, the great defensive victory, and then the Masurian Lakes victory. I only point that out to let you know that multiple Russian commanders made the decision, we don't want to attack the Germans. So that made the Austro-Hungarians the unhappy recipients of the Russian offensives in the future. 1915 brought a great deal of bloodletting for Austria-Hungary and Russia. Carpathian Winter War, which I wrote a book on, never been written a battle before because all the languages were necessary, changes the history of World War I. 1.8 million Russian, 1.4 million Russian casualties, 800,000 Austro-Hungarian, almost 250,000 German in less than 3 months, as I probably said before. But I want to point something out when I'm talking about the Eastern Front. When you look at 1915 and the Gorlice-Tarnow, the greatest victory of the Central Powers, it is not World War II the scorched earth policy began. It was in 1915 with the Gorlice-Tarnow offensive. It was not the Second World War where racial hatred and killing people of various nationalities occurred. It was after Gorlice-Tarnow. The Russians going one way, and then the Austro-Hungarians coming back, and the Jews were caught in the middle. You're probably aware of the Brusilov offensive of 1916. Oh, let me go back, I'm sorry. Gorlice-Tarnow. The Russians lost at least 1 million casualties on the battlefield and well over 1 million prisoners of war. So you start adding this up, it becomes enormous. But during 1916, the Brusilov offensive, everybody writes about the Austro-Hungarian army lost 750,000 troops, and sadly, 450,000 were prisoners of war, which doesn't say much for their leadership. But the Russians also lost well over 1 million. And it's the losses in the Brusilov offensive in this great victory that is going to lead you into the first Russian Revolution a year later. Meanwhile, in the Austro-Hungarian monarchy, the blockade had stopped food coming in. The Austro-Hungarian government thought they could feed their people in a war. They found out they couldn't. And one of the major reasons, which you don't always catch when you read the books, is in the opening campaign, when the Russians won their outstanding victory, August 26th into September, and the Austro-Hungarian army lost 400,000 soldiers, the Russians captured the Polish province of Galicia. Why is this important? It's critical to understand what happens for the rest of the war. Already in 1914, the Austro-Hungarian monarchy had lost 1/4 of its grain supplies that came from Galicia. It lost its major oil supply, and it lost manpower. That was a great source of troops, so the Russians going in or going out would either force the young men that are still in the villages, et cetera, into the army, or drive them east to the refugees, and that's the other problem. In the battles in the Polish frontier areas, refugees, hundreds of thousands of Jews, Ruthenians, Poles, et cetera, moved down into the empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire. There was no food for them, but they became the blunt of, they are foreigners. They are not truly part of our people, but they were. And here again comes a hatred for the Jews. The Ruthenians can't read or write. I mean, they couldn't even stand sentry duty. They couldn't remember one word. And so this is where the racial hatred builds up and increases, and particularly with the 100,000 or so who move into Vienna, mostly Jewish people, ran into a lot of trouble. We all know that 1917, the major events were the United States coming in the war and, of course, Russia going out. Well, what caused Russia to go out? The Kerensky Offensive. A lot of people don't realize, but in 1917, the Russian army was the largest it ever was in World War I. Kerensky had gotten enough power. He went to the front lines trying to get the troops. I can't go into detail, but the Russian commanders did not want to launch the offensive originally. They had purges in the army with the revolution, the first Russian revolution. A lot of discourse, but the Entente is pressing them. You've got to attack. So Kerensky is going to launch his infamous Kerensky Offensive. They could call it the Brusilov Offensive, too. Again, who is attacked? The hapless Austro-Hungarians. They're driven back 30 miles. But what is interesting is that the Germans and Austro-Hungarians knew that the attack was coming, and they actually made plans to launch a counteroffensive as it began. However, the Austro-Hungarian army, God bless them, retreated 30 miles. But that would bring about the big results for the Kerensky Offensive, because the Germans had planned to bring 5 to 6 divisions from the Western Front as soon as that offensive began, and those troops hit from the north and struck the Russian flank. The Russian troops fled. The battle was over. I'm cutting a lot of detail out, obviously. This is, for those of you who are my age, I'm doing what's called Tuesday, if it's Tuesday, you're in Belgium, that movie. But anyway, the Germans struck on July 19th. The Russian army melts away. So what occurs? Well, we have the Second Russian Revolution, which is affected by all this. And Lenin comes to power. We just heard last time the evil Lenin. Lenin wanted to stop the war. In fact, the Germans sent him to Russia in a sealed railroad car to foment trouble and were paying him as you had the Bolshevik Revolution going on. They had no idea what it was going to end up. But the point is that Lenin wanted a peace treaty, and this starts in December 1917, the Brest-Litovsk negotiations. They don't go very far, and they're actually broken off at the end of December because of the Bolshevik propaganda going on and on and on. But the German general staff, in their very unique public relations way, said, "We're going to invade if you don't sign the damn treaty." Well, they signed the treaty. The German armies move into Western Russia and seize the Baltic states. Now, you know, poor little Austria-Hungary, Kaiser Karl just hated violence. Incompetent, well-meaning. He said, we're not going to go into there. We can't do it. Our people are starving and all that. But then he found out that there was the possibility of 1 million tons of grain in the Ukraine. So Karl said, go on in. Now, it's important to understand what this signifies, because there weren't a lot of Austro-Hungarian troops that went in. In fact, there was one soldier for every 6 kilometers. And their job was very simple. Get food. We're starving. Vienna's starving. The entire dual monarchy starving. Why is this important? Because all of a sudden, it started early in the war, but by 1918, you're having riots. The masses are now getting involved in politics. I'm going to tell you, when I get to the Italian front, the troops in the 6th Army weighed an average of 120 pounds, and they've got to launch an offensive as they're coming down with Spanish flu and malaria. This is the Austro-Hungarian Army in 1918. On the Italian front, they're digging up graves because they don't have uniforms. There is no more textiles. The uniforms are being made out of paper. Their boots are made out of it. They're digging up graves from 1914 and 15 when the troops were buried in full uniform so they can have them. When Kaiser Karl comes to visit a regiment, Two-thirds of the troops don't even have half a uniform. They are starving. They're freezing. It's just, it's absolutely incredible. Nobody understands really, unless you go into this, the horrible conditions that Austria-Hungary was going through. Anyway, jumped ahead of myself here. What did the Brest-Litovsk Treaty do for Russia? Well, Russia was amputated, basically. The Bolsheviks had to evacuate Latvia, Estonia, and Finland and recognize the Ukrainian People's Republic. Thus, the Russians were pushed way back on the Eastern Front. Now, I'm going to tell you some of the facts so you understand how much the Russians gave up in this treaty. 1.3 million square miles, which was one-third of Russia's arable land, three-quarters of its iron deposits, and one-third of its factories, as well as one-quarter of its railroads. Thus, 73% of its iron sources and 89% of its coal was lost. But as I'm sure you know, Lenin figured with the revolution would spread west and he gained the territory back. They would indeed get it back once Austria-Hungary and Germany had been defeated. Now let's talk about Italy. Jake, can you turn off that? My teaching assistants always did this stuff for me. My wife says, I don't need to worry about you going to chat clubs. You have no idea how to get to them. But so anyway, Italy had become a member of the Triple Alliance with Germany and Austria-Hungary, as you know, since 1882. But in early August 1914, it declared its neutrality. From that point on, the Italians would launch 11 Isonzo offensives. This is a little misleading because the second and third, were launched in the high mountains, and General Cardorna finally figured out we're not going to get anywhere in these giant peaks in the Alps, so he moves it down to the Isonzo River. There are 11 offensives there. One thing I want you to be aware of that a lot of people are not, is when you get to the 10th and 11th Isonzo battles in 1917, the losses of men is greater than the Battle of Verdun. And that doesn't count the daily losses and the losses in between the actual battles. So again, one has to realize the enormity of the casualties, and you'll help understand, if you look at Italy at the end of the war, how Benito Mussolini is able to move up. But the point is, the Austro-Hungarian army, when the war was first declared, if General Cadorna had actually invaded, he could have gone all the way. He said, I'm going to go all the way to Vienna. Yeah, lots of luck. The Austro-Hungarian troops were grossly outnumbered, were not well armed. In fact, the first troops to defend there were the Schützentruppen, and they were basically mountaineers. And their best people, mountain fighters, had died on the plains of Galicia in 1914 and at Gorlice Tarnow. So it's basically young boys and older men who are the first ones to guard at the Italian frontier. Make a long story short, the Italians don't attack for a month, and that saved Austria-Hungary. But the English and the British think the Italians really are not good fighters. They're not doing well. And I've had students say, well, you know, look at Caporetto. They don't know how to fight. The Italians, well, Caporetto's a different story, but the Italians had to go up the mountains. And Cadorna sent them up shoulder to shoulder. In some cases, and we don't have time for the battles, 60 to 80% of regiments were wiped out. But you know, they sometimes gained territory because the Austro-Hungarian troops ran out of ammunition, or the Italian artillery by 1917, 3,800 barrels, leveled mountaintops and killed everything on the mountains. The war with Italy is one of the most brutal things. And what you don't realize, besides battles, many soldiers lost their lives to avalanches. In one day, the Austro-Hungarian army lost 1,271 men to avalanches. Many froze to death. Cable cars collapsed. They couldn't repair cable cars. How do you get back and forth in the mountains? Water. One of the biggest problems for the Italians and the Austro-Hungarian troops is water. Now it rains, but the Austro-Hungarian and Italian troops couldn't drink the water because in the water were corpses, blood from the wounded, every kind of fecal matter, because you're slammed in an area, and those veterans who have served will tell you, you can't just walk and say, stop firing, I want to go take a poop. So all this is there, and the Austro-Hungarian troops would go into caves when the Italian artillery fired, and the Italian artillery outnumbered theirs 3-1. But what you don't read in textbooks, when the artillery fire got intense, the soldiers moved the wounded out of the caverns, and they went into the caverns. Quite brutal. Anyway, it became very evident that you can't dig foxholes in Rocky Mountain terrain. So you had to bring in dynamite and machinery to create caverns. You also had to realize in the mountains that when artillery fired, they didn't have helmets in the first couple years of the war. And so that any shell that exploded caused enormous and multiple head wounds. The most famous battle on this front is Caporetto. Why was there the battle in the first place? Because it's critical to understand Caporetto for 1918, because when the Italians finally attack in 1918, they choose the exact day the Caporetto began, which was October 24th. By 1917, the Austro-Hungarian forces were able to send troops from the Russian front when that front supposedly, quote, collapsed. So the Italians launched the 10th and 11th offensives. And again, here, this is what I should have said in the beginning. You heard a lot about the Western Front. The Western Front and the Eastern Front battles and the Italian Front battles, even the Caucasus Front, all intersected. You can't look at them as an individual thing in the West. You've got to look at the Eastern Front and the others. But anyway, with the 10th and 11th Isonzo battles, the Austro-Hungarian army was bled white. Their manpower, they did not think they had enough manpower to even field the army in 1918, and they begged the Germans to help them. And good old Ludendorff said, no. We've got Flanders, we've got Riga, we've got this, we've got that. But then it became obvious that one more attack by the Italians and Austria-Hungary is out of the war. Now the key to Caporetto is the weather. Because when the 11th Isonzo battle ended, there was only about a month you could move before the winter weather set in. So the good old German army and its railroads and efficiency, Ludendorff says, yes, we'll come down. So they send 7 divisions. Now, the Battle of Caporetto is when 35 German and Austro-Hungarian divisions attack well over 40 Italian ones. The key to this is the Italians were used to the Austro-Hungarians. They were not used to German artillery. German gas shells and enormous firepower caught them by surprise on October 24th, 1917, and drove them back. They were not used to gas, and the air reconnaissance, everything changed with air power for you airplane fans. Before Caporetto, the Italian Air Force was building up and building up so the Austro-Hungarians could do nothing. They couldn't do reconnaissance, and the Italians were always going over, dropping bombs. They even dropped leaflets over Vienna, a total insult to the Austro-Hungarian Air Force. But the Germans came with their airplanes. And the first thing they did was force the Italians out of the airspace. And their air recon positioned all the Italian artillery in positions, etc. So the main front lines were hit with gas shells, the communication centers, and where the reserve troops were, and the Italians were thrown totally off balance. Just to show you the difference with the Germans helping them, the Austro-Hungarian army in 1916 and 17 and 18 could not move two-thirds of their artillery because all the horses were dead. So they only had a third of the artillery, and then you still had the movement of mountains. Well, the Germans changed all that, but the one thing I want to explain to you is the Germans only did this to keep Austria-Hungary in the war. They did not want to totally defeat Italy, because Austria-Hungary would probably leave the war, and that was something they didn't want to do. Now I'm going to talk about Austria-Hungary in the last year of the war. The nationalities, if you're interested in the nationality question, the nationalities did not cause any trouble in the Austro-Hungarian monarchy until 1917, for a simple reason: Germany. And in fact, I suggest that one of the reasons that the Austro-Hungarians would accept German commands what to do in 1918 is because the Austro-Hungarian leadership tied their fortune to Germany in order to avoid the nationality question, to avoid revolutions. When the war was announced against Russia and Serbia, over half the population of Austria-Hungary were Slavic peoples, and they didn't want to fight them. In Italy, they did, because it was Slavic land that the Slavic soldiers realized the Italians wanted. But anyway, beginning of 1918, the rationing, which had been cut and cut and cut, is cut again in the beginning of January. Riots spread all over the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. The whole key here is that the central government, from the beginning of the war, had been unable to solve any of the social or economic, and particularly nationality, questions. So the government is becoming threatened greatly. And in fact, when you get toward the end of the war, the officials in what became Czechoslovakia and the other countries start working and build national councils. They're already working to end the empire. And this is why there's no violent revolution with the decline of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. The officials who had been running for the Habsburgs now run it for the Romanians and for the other people. Anyway, on both the home front and on the battlefields, the soldiers were starving. The civilians were starving. The Austro-Hungarian army had insufficient equipment. Industry had almost come to a halt. Picture an army fighting for their life, and after 1916, the entire railroad transportation system in Austria-Hungary was collapsing or was collapsed. And that's why the Ukraine is such an important thing to mention. When Austro-Hungarian troops go into the Ukraine, they extend their front over 1,000 miles. Their railroad system's collapsing. And this is when I come to the Balkans. People don't understand the end of the war starts with the Balkans, not on the Western Front, and I'll get to that very shortly. Anyway, I told you before, the soldiers didn't have full uniforms. They're eating dried vegetables. When I talk about the last Austro-Hungarian offensive in June 15th, 1918, the soldiers only did it because they knew the Italians had food and they were starving. The army was down to 3 days' supply of food. They'd run out of cattle. In fact, well, I'll mention this too. If it weren't for the conquest of Romania in 1916, Germany and Austria-Hungary would have had to bow out of the war. It was Hungarian oil and grain that kept them in almost to the end. And Austro-Hungarian cities starved during the winter when the Danube was frozen and they couldn't bring the grain up, but that's another story. When the Austro-Hungarian army launches its last offensive, it was because the German high command demanded it. You've got to tie down the Italian troops, as if the Italians are going to send enormous numbers of troops up to the Western Front. But the Austro-Hungarian army, if you listen to what I've said, the soldiers were starving. Equipment wasn't getting to them because industry had collapsed. The railroads couldn't deliver food to the cities. The railroads couldn't deliver coal to the army or to the cities. It was, when I pictured, although I'm a vet, when I picture those soldiers, I don't know how in the living daylights they went, because they were absolutely starving. The shells were misfiring because of the poor production. About every fourth artillery shell in the Austro-Hungarian army was not going off. But the title I give to another historians, I'm not the only one, for this last offensive by the Austro-Hungarian army, I call the Hunger Offensive, for obvious reasons. problem with Austria-Hungary was poor leadership all the way through, be it political or military. For this last offensive, Kaiser Karl did not have, I almost said a bad word, did not have the backbone to make a decision between Conrad, who wanted to attack out of the mountains of Tyrol, or Borovic on the Isonzo front. So they launched an offensive with an army that wasn't prepared for it on a 100-mile front. The Isonzo, of course, separated from Tyrol. Well, the Italians knew it was coming. So the Tyrolean offensive ends almost immediately, within a day or two. But on the Isonzo front, which you read in the textbooks, read in the books and not what happened up in the mountains, again, weather and terrain, the Piava River floods. So the Austro-Hungarian troops put their pontoons there, the troops go across, pontoon bridges are swept away, troops are drowned, and they get there. And your textbooks tell you that, you know, all the Italians beat the living daylights out of them. No. These poor soldiers actually got to the third line of defense of many Italian defensive positions. They captured the Montello Mountain, which you probably never heard of, but it was the key to Italian defenses and supply. But then they ran out of steam. And the Italians, and this is, the textbooks tell you, the Italians won this great victory at Vittorio Veneto. I'm sorry, that is absolute, not a bad word, but BS. Bull dash with D replacing the S. The Austro-Hungarian general staff made a terrible, terrible blunder. They thought their army would last long enough in the field in 1918 that they would have an honorable peace. In fact, all the things I've read when they're talking to their negotiators, all we want is an honorable peace. We do not want to have it sound like a capitulation. The Italians weren't going to attack. That June 15th offensive, the Italians were not going to attack, but the Entente power said, attack, come on, what's wrong with you? Now you tie the Western Front in. You've had the German offensives, and now the Entente is moving ahead and they're retreating. And General Diaz, who has replaced Cadorna, is kicked in the butt by the government, and he realizes, we gotta do something, we're gonna lose all that nice territory we were promised in 1915 in the Treaty of London. So they launch their offensive again on October 24th, 1918, the exact day of the offensive at Caporetto. Well, the army is falling apart, but here's what the Italians did when you think they won this great victory. The Austro-Hungarian negotiators were convinced that they were told the war would end on November 3rd on the Italian front at 3 p.m. So they sent out, General Arts sent out a thing saying, fighting stops on November 3rd at 3 p.m. After he did that, the Italians said, oh, wait a minute, no, it can't be till November 4th at 3 p.m. A lot of people died because of that. The Italians, I'll say this, the Austro-Hungarian troops that did not fight back when the Italians attacked a day later, when those troops stood to fight, these were basically German-Hungarian units, the Italians, being very brave, went the other direction. The tragedy was the troops who had already thrown their arms down or were heading home. They were chased by cav units, motorcycle units. 360,000 to 400,000 Austro-Hungarian soldiers become prisoners of war. The Italians did not have the facilities to take care of them or feed them. 30,000 would die. The Slavic troops were let out within a couple of weeks, but the Germans and Hungarians are the ones who are left there to die or to return much later. Now, I want to briefly, I got to watch for Laura because she's going to give me the hook. One letter is very important in understanding the fall of the Austro-Hungarian army. It's called the Sixtus letter. This was when Kaiser Karl gets the brother of Empress Zita to send a letter to France where he suggests that Austria-Hungary would make a separate peace and would allow Alsace-Lorraine to go to Germany. To make a long story short, Czernin, who was a foreign minister, there are rumors that Carl sent this letter, and Chernin says to Carl, did you send this a letter? And Carl lied and said, no, I did not. So Chernin made a big mistake without knowing it. He goes and makes a talk to the National Assembly. The French are making their usual ploys. They're saying we're looking for peace and we aren't. And Clemenceau went bazoo. He had the letter published in the French press. That's the beginning of the end, because the Austro-Germans and the Hungarians, the strongest supporters of the dynasty, have now lost their trust in him because he lied. And that's why I wanted to mention this letter, because a lot of times people don't understand, but it's important to realize what happens then in 1918. I'm going to skip ahead because I'm seeing I'm not as far as I wanted to be. So I'm going to talk about the Caucasus. Well, if I get to the Balkans, I won't. If you're in the Balkans, you're in trouble. Okay. I don't need the notes. I don't know why I'm looking for them. Balkan front. You've got to understand, this is far more important than your books tell you. The Austro-Hungarian soldiers are starving. So were the Turkish soldiers. So were the Bulgarian soldiers. The Salonika army out of Greece, which Falkenhayn said was the largest internment in military history, launched an attack on September 15, 1918. And these troops drive the Bulgarians back. And what you don't read in the textbooks is the Bulgarians plead with Germany and Austria-Hungary, by our treaty, you've got to send six divisions to help us to stop this invasion. Germany and Austria-Hungary couldn't. You've got the Western Front up there, but the railroads can't remove troops from Romania and the Ukraine and get there in time. So the Bulgarian government surrenders on October 28th, I think. And this is the key. If you know your geography, if Bulgaria has surrendered, it means that Turkey is isolated. She cannot be supported by Germany or Austria-Hungary. And that leads immediately, October 30th, 1918, to that Treaty of Mutros you heard in the last excellent presentation. This is the beginning of the end. Because the terms of the treaty with Bulgaria, you demobilize immediately, you evacuate all territory your troops are in, and you turn over your railroads and allow us full transport to the Serbian and Austro-Hungarian frontiers. Already on September 20th, the Serbian front is collapsing. So you have these troops moving in, and the Austro-Hungarian and German troops, number one, it's a heck of a thing the German troops trying to get out of Bulgaria, the few that were there. And by the way, the German troops were pulled out for the offensive up north, just like they were pulled out of Russia for the final offensive. So the Entente forces are really moving forward. The Germans and Austro-Hungarians are putting up piecemeal defense, and you reach the Danube River. This is where Austria-Hungary is in trouble, because when they have to sign their peace treaty, it has the same thing, but the most important thing is, we can use your railroads, and it was a threat of immediate invasion of Germany. So don't just think it was the defeats on the Western Front that led to the end of the war with the Germans. The Entente was right at their doors at Austria-Hungary. In fact, Bavaria wanted to send troops down to fight them coming in, but they didn't have enough. They were either dead or they're on the Western Front. So the Balkan Front was very, very important. I want to mention the Caucasus front. I'm not doing the maps I had here because I said my TAs used to do that. And technologically, I'm still with the first computers. But anyway, Caucasus. The Caucasus drew Russian troops to the mountains because the Turks sent an army of 200,000 troops to try to gain territory back. Because the Caucasus War is going back to 1854-56, the Crimean War, and the 1877-78 Russo-Turkish War. So the Turks are gonna try to get land back. They send 200,000 troops. Now listen to this for brilliance in military affairs. The Turks had to march 500 miles from their last railroad to get to the mountains. And when they go in the mountains, 35,000 of those troops freeze to death before they even get into combat. Well, between 1914 and 17, the Russians win some inconclusive victories. The Turks are basically beaten in most of the battles. But what happens? That Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, March 3rd, 1918, the Caucasus Mountains are turned over to Turkey. Fantastic. Well, it doesn't last long because the peace will end. Now, I wanted to just talk about Germany again before, if I have time to go to Africa. Ah, she's coming. How much time? 1 hour? Great. Okay, well, I want to get the heck out of here. I want to talk about Africa a little bit because people don't realize. Oh, by the way, for Asia, the war, any fighting was done in 1914 in Tsing Tao when the Japanese captured the German fort. There's nothing of real battle there until after the war. I do want to mention, though, that when the Japanese took the islands north of the equator, that's where American blood would flow in the Marshall Islands. I don't need to name Iwo Jima, etc. Africa. Africa only had 2 to 3% of the trade with Europe, but it's important as it was in World War II, in this war, and in today for raw materials. But the French raised 600,000 black troops to fight for them. And if you read about the battles on the Western Front, the French were very good at driving, using the Arab North Africans and the blacks of Africa to lead the offensives. So if you look at the number of medals won by French army units, the vast majority are not from French troops. The French were trying to save their own blood. Well, they raised 600,000. Half of the troops they sent to Europe, which I believe is around 160,000 on the French front in the beginning, over half become casualties. The troops can't fight in cold weather. So for half the war, they had to be sent down to South France because they can't pull the triggers because it's so cold. But I want to mention the effect on Africa. The only fighting is done in East Africa. The Germans had conquered Togoland, the Cameroons, and Southwest Africa within the first 2 years of the war. But the Germans had an incredible commander, Letov Forbeck. One of the greatest irregular commanders, I think, in history. With 3,000 German troops and 12,000 Askaris, the black troops, 15,000 troops, they tied down between 130 to 150,000 Entente troops. The thing about Africa fighting, it was small units. If you had an artillery piece, you were going to win the battle. But battles were stopped by charging rhinoceri, bee swarms, and patrols went out at night, and they'd be found the next day. The lions had a good dinner overnight. But the point is that Africa suffered unbelievable ecological and environmental damage. Hundreds of thousands of families were destroyed. The troops, the soldiers who were mostly dragooned, they did not volunteer, were promised land when they got back. Well, families fled into the interland, et cetera, families were destroyed. When the war ended, of course, these black troops did not get the land they were promised. Guess where the rebel commanders came from in Africa to try to end imperialism? Well, and imperialism didn't end until after the Second World War, but that's what happened there. Middle East, say quickly, before Laura comes here and beats me on the head. Middle East, I just want to mention, the warfare there was what the Europeans expected in 1914. And as you heard from the last talk, it was combined arms. And one of the key battles was Megiddo. Megiddo was this huge source of water, the wells. So using cav, now I was armored cav and then air cav, using cavalry forces, which were wiped out in the opening battles of 1914, basically, Allenby took Megiddo before the Turks could poison the water. They had to have the water to continue the Palestinian campaign to drive on. Now, here's what I want to mention. David Lloyd George is the mastermind behind the Mideast campaign. He couldn't stand the bloodshed at the Somme and particularly Passchendaele. So he wanted victories for the British people. So he's the one that said to Allenby, you've got to take Jerusalem by Christmas. And Allenby does. Well, Megiddo, by the way, after that, the Turks lost a third of their army after that battle. I'm going to wrap this up right now, Laura. So Allenby takes his troops up there. It's a perfect example of combined arms, everything. The Air Force was very important. The airplanes literally wiped out two Turkish armies as they were fleeing. So we have in the Middle East, the British have taken this land, and there was one reason. Oil. Their battleships took oil. Nobody else's did. So their chief goal was oil. This is why you had the Mesopotamian campaign. This is why you had the campaign through Palestine. Because if you look at a map to the British, we've got the Suez Canal, we've got Egypt. We need Palestine to protect that route, as our previous speaker said, because India was the key. I thank you for your attention, and if we have time for questions.
We do. We will likely have about time for two questions. So please feel free to make your way to the microphone. And I appreciate you saying that. And the oil piece, if you take a look, two of my most favorite artifacts from our collection actually have to do with oil. When you go inside the main gallery, you will find right at the end of the timeline on the east, in the east gallery, is a pamphlet about the importance of Baghdad. Where the British outline the importance and the need for oil. Anytime anyone asks me, how does World War I connect to today? That's a really easy artifact and thing to point them to. There's a beautiful picture inside our online collections database of I believe it's a Russian cavalry with oil rigs in the background that is just incredibly stunning. So I'd encourage you to take a look at that. Artifacts that we have here certainly support those things that you are saying. And our first question.
Well, can I just say something? It was the dreadnought. The British had developed the dreadnought, and one dreadnought could wipe out the entire rest of their fleet of 220 ships, and they never see those ships when they were firing at them. Okay. Question.
To what degree is influenza having an effect on these various fronts? Which more, which less?
That's an excellent question. I was in a hurry because I was afraid of Laura beating me on the head. The Spanish flu is critical. If you listen to what I said about malnutrition with the Austro-Hungarian troops and stuff, by the time they launched their offensive in June 1918, they had lost over 100,000 already of Spanish flu. And it was hitting Germany because the people weren't eating there either. They didn't have food, but mostly the young and elderly. The Spanish flu is critical. Totally misunderstudied with the effects of war in 1918. A great question. And by the way, it's called Spanish flu. That's because the Spanish were the first ones to record it. It actually happened in Kansas. That's where it started, if you didn't know it. Yes, sir.
Question from someone who lives right next to the camp where Spanish flu began.
I'm staying away from you.
we're dangerous people out there in western Kansas. I'd like to ask about the interplay of the Salonika and Italian fronts in 1918. And even if the Germans had been able to stop the 100 Days Offensive, would the combination of Franchet d'Esprit's offensive breaking the Bulgarians and the offensive in Italy have been enough to knock Austria-Hungary out of the war and collapse the German position anyway?
That's an excellent question. No matter what happened on the Western Front, what happened in the Balkans is going to happen. The Slavic army is not going to stop because of whatever, and Italy is going to win their victory because of the peace treaty. But yes, the German front, the German army had collapsed, but if the Germans had kept fighting and the Slavic army had gotten up to their frontier, then they're really in trouble. That's why I explained the Balkan Wars. The Balkan front is critical to understand what happened in 1918. But excellent question. Thank you. I hope I answered it.
You did. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please join me in thanking Dr. Graydon Tunstall?
Thank you.